the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In reflecting upon the epistle reading for today, Presbyterian pastor Gordon McClellan shares the story of a friend of his named Benjamin Youssef. Benjamin was raised in Africa by a strict Muslim family. When he decided to become a Christian, his father disowned him and banished him from their home. Benjamin decided to leave his native land for a more tolerant society. His feet being his only method of transportation, he began walking to the border. Along the way, he was captured and put in prison, and the prison guards would spend every night for several months trying to beat a renunciation out of him. Benjamin never renounced his faith. Instead, he would forgive the guards at the conclusion of every beating. One of the jailers became intrigued by Benjamin, who offered such love in the face of such cruelty, and one night after a particularly vicious beating, the jailer came to the cell to ask Benjamin why he forgave him and the other guards after every beating. Benjamin told the guards about Jesus and the lessons of selfless love and forgiveness he taught. The guard left in disbelief, but returned much later that night with the surprise announcement that he had come to help Benjamin escape. Escape he did, eventually making his way to the United States, where he wound up earning a PhD in religious studies before returning to Africa to plant churches. Benjamin's story reminds me as well of the story of St. Patrick. St. Patrick, a Roman Briton, Patrick's father was a deacon, his grandfather was a priest, but Patrick had no faith of his own. Until when he was 16, he was captured by Irish pirates, and he was held as a slave in Ireland for 6 years. Patrick eventually escaped, returned to Britain, having been drawn back to God during the period of his captivity. And Patrick studied, was ordained a priest, and then Patrick returned to Ireland, to the place of his enslavement, in order to preach the gospel, the good news of God in Jesus Christ. Both of these stories, those of Benjamin and that of Patrick, are inspiring, I think, for the ways in which both of these Christians were willing to return to a place of pain and suffering in the hope of spreading the gospel there. But those stories are even further removed from our own lives, I think, because even if we could imagine returning to a place of persecution, the fact is we probably find it even harder to imagine what it would be like to be persecuted for our faith in the first place. After all, for all the protests that bubble up every now and then in social media about a war in Christianity in America, those of us who live in the United States have a pretty tame existence as Christians. We're able to worship freely. We can share our experience of God in Christ with no repercussions. There's little danger to our worship space, to our families, to our friends, because of our choice to be disciples. Compared to our sisters and brothers around the world, compared to the 29 Coptic Christians who were gunned down on buses this past week, buses that had small children in them. Compared to all of this, following Christ in the United States doesn't generally cost us very much at all. It carries very little risk. And all of that makes texts like this epistle reading from 1 Peter a bit difficult to interpret, I think. When the author of 1 Peter writes, "Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that's taking place among you to test you as though something strange were happening." We hear that and likely raise our eyebrows. Our lives generally do not feel as though being Christians causes us to go through fiery ordeals of faith. And he continues a few verses later, if you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory, which is the Spirit of God, is resting on you. And it's unlikely, hearing that many of us are terribly worried about being reviled for the name of Christ in our own lives anytime soon. And so I think texts like this should raise important questions for us about the way in which we follow Christ today. After all, when Christ instituted his ministry in the Gospel of Luke, he was clear about what he was here to do. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, he said, quoting Isaiah, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. This is what Jesus was about. This is what Jesus' followers are to be about. Earlier in the first letter of Peter, the author urged his audience before our reading today, therefore, prepare your minds for action. Discipline yourselves. Set all your hope on the grace that Jesus Christ will bring you when he is revealed. Like obedient children, don't be conformed to the desires you formerly had in ignorance. All of that is to say, following Christ should fundamentally change you. It should fundamentally change the world in which you live. And following Christ should be risky at times. After all, the powers of this world don't generally actually care what you believe in, so long as you pay your taxes, don't upset the status quo, and enable the whole system to just keep moving along. The early Christians were persecuted not just for their belief in the lordship of Jesus Christ. They were persecuted because the empire knew that if people followed Jesus as their Lord, they would not devote themselves to the state. Because the empire knew that these Christians claimed it was their job to go about raising up the oppressed. The state knew that the claim of another ruler in Jesus was dangerous to those who ruled in that time. And so modern Christians must ask ourselves very carefully, if the reason the church in the United States, for example, is not really terribly under threat, if the reason we as Christians have our life so easy is because we have made an unholy peace with the empire, the powers, and the systems of this world. As one author notes, to live the gospel is threatening. Liberation for the oppressed is a direct assault on the forms of subjugation that society has legitimized. Have we traded the lordship of Christ for the comfort and safety of a system that grinds down those in need? Do we actually preach a message of liberation for the oppressed, release for the captives, and mean it? Or does the world take our gospel even less seriously than we do? Does the world know not to worry about the church in America? Because though we talk a good talk, we're actually pretty comfortable, pretty focused on getting what we can out of having a nice, meaningful, spiritual life. We're probably not going to be upsetting things anytime soon. Resist the devil, the author of 1 Peter proclaims. Resist the devil. He says the devil is like a roaring lion just looking for someone to devour. He reminds us that whether or not we suffer, our sisters and brothers around the world are suffering, and so we are called to a sacred resistance. A resistance against evil, a resistance against oppression, a resistance against the very mechanisms of wealth that make us so comfortable. We are called to resist these things in a way that is risky, in a way that may cost us at times, in a way that will upset those in power. We are called to resist these things. Resist the devil, the author of 1 Peter says, steadfast in your faith. And sometimes the most profound form of resistance is at least first to refuse to be comfortable here, to refuse to be lulled into inactivity, to allow our hearts to be provoked by the Holy Spirit so that we might rise up. So, you want to know a good place to start? You want to know how to begin to live a life of faith that is risky, one that actually makes a difference in the world? I've got a fantastic idea for you. You can start by just trying to at least talk about your faith, to talk about the risky, grace-filled life of discipleship you believe you are called to. Start there, just talk about it. A study not too long ago found that 80% of Christians believe they have a responsibility to share their faith, but nearly two-thirds of Christians haven't actually talked to another person about their Christianity in the past 6 months. Nearly half of those surveyed have never even invited an unchurched friend to come to church with them. Oh, and by the way, this was a study of evangelicals. You could imagine what the numbers would be for, Episcopalians. Because actually the numbers are even more disheartening when it comes to mainline Christianity, the Episcopal Church of which we're a part. According to research by the Barna Group, only 54% of mainline Christians think they have a responsibility to share their faith. Only 54% of people in the church think they have a responsibility to do exactly what Jesus said in this gospel reading for today, to go out and be witnesses to what God is doing in Christ in our lives and in this world. Only about half think they should probably do that. They should probably talk about it. Even more fascinating is that this same study found that those most likely to share their faith are low income people, because they are not co-opted by the system in the same way. And oddly enough, you know who the second most likely to share their faith was? Wealthy people, because they're not co-opted by the system either. They're just fine. You know who's least likely to share their faith among mainline Christians? The middle class. Those of us neither at the bottom nor at the top. Those of us simply participating in the grueling systems of this world, we're the ones least likely to tell someone about God in Christ. The whole of the New Testament is predicated upon a community that freely and openly shared their experience of God in Jesus Christ, that fundamentally altered the way that they existed as a society, so that no one was hungry, so that no one would have to be afraid of where they were going to live, of where their next meal was going to come from. The whole world was upended by those early Christians. That's one of the reasons why it was sometimes difficult for them, why they found themselves persecuted. And yet it's also why thousands upon thousands were added to the church each day in those first centuries. It's how lives were changed in that time, by simply being willing to talk about what you believe about God in Christ, to say something, and even more, to invite someone to be a part of the sacred resistance that being a disciple of Christ actually is. You are a part of it, beloved of God. You're part of a sacred resistance. But I want to tell you something. That does not mean simply posting your strongly held political views about social justice on Facebook. That is not being a sacred resistance. You're part of a sacred resistance when you refuse to let the devil lull you into comfort, into acquiescence to the powers of this world. You're part of a sacred resistance when you wake up by the power of the Spirit of God, when you wake up and resist the devil and all the evil he is trying to do in this world. You're part of a sacred resistance when you turn to the person next to you who doesn't know if there's a place for them at all with God, and you tell them, come, be a part of this. So ask yourself, what kind of life you're called to live as a Christian? Ask yourself what it might mean for your faith to become just a little bit more risky, a little bit riskier tomorrow than it is today. What it might mean for your faith to cost you something. Maybe not what it cost Benjamin Yusuf or the great Saint Patrick, but at least something, so that the sacred resistance might grow, so that a community of love and mercy and kindness might grow, so that the devils in this world will be shut up by the powers of this church. You are called, beloved of God, to risky faith. You are not called to a comfortable life.